Eu estou muito contente de falar com vocês de novo, os bons vizinhos que partilhamos a península. E, I'm happy to speak in this Lisbon webinar. I have been visiting Portugal from the time I was very young, and we are good neighbors. And I will speak about some mathematics I've been doing. Usually I begin with a generic introduction because even if the experts know that, in the audience there are always people who like to get some panorama of what in the end I am doing. So I have four chapters. Diffusion is a very general introduction. Fractional is be to just for you to know what we mean by fractional. We don't mean all the fractional stuff. And then what I will try to explain is my work in the last 3 years about these fractional pillar placement operators, how we have been trying to build the theory so that people can work with them like another tool in the machinery of PD people. And the last thing I'm doing now is fast diffusion flows, which is something I always like to do. Okay, so if I go to this diffusion, it's a very general presentation. Is that diffusion is something that comes from physics and has a solid foundation in the physical sciences. And the diffusion equations must describe how a continuous medium, for instance, a population, spreads to occupy available space. And this has to be made precise, but it's good to present first the evidence from the physical sciences. The fluids have diffusion, chemicals have diffusion, bacteria diffuse, animal populations diffuse, the momentum of a Newtonian fluid diffuses according to Navier-Stokes, and there is diffusion in the stock market and many other diffusion processes. So the problem is not discussing with the people in physics what is diffusion, they already know. The question for us is, what is it for a mathematician? How do you put the numbers? And then you want to do analysis, not only models, but also do rigorous analysis. And this question has been considered by mathematicians in the last century, and they gave two different answers, and both answers have been incredibly successful in the 20th century. One of the directions is the diffusion related to random walk and the continuous limit as a stochastic process. And this is a correct answer according to the people in physics. They have been doing that for a long time. And the approach leads to Brownian motion, which is one of the main objects that has been invented in the 20th century. And to the stochastic processes, they have a general theory that the main representative was Ito, Kiyoshi Ito. And they write a stochastic differential equation for the random movement of a particle whose position with x. X sub t means x at the time t, and differential is the elementary movement. And there is one term that represents the deterministic movement due to driving forces, which is not stochastic. And another term that represents a certain diffusivity times the main object of this Brownian model, which is the Wiener process. So it's a random walk in the continuous model. And this is very interesting, but I am not a person in probability, so I will not go into that because it is not my stuff. Just it is to show my respect. The second direction is that maybe you can do functional analysis and PDEs and do the same thing with densities instead of doing elementary movements of a Markovian process, you do the PDEs corresponding to the density formulation. And this was proposed by Andrei Kolmogorov in the 1930s. And the basic equation, according to him, was the heat equation. In fact, you find the Fokker-Planck equations, but let's see the heat equation is good enough to begin with. And understanding this double way has been the source of much effort. and the work still goes on. And this is, I mean, it makes us very happy. We're still working on that. And I will follow in my talks the way coming from analysis, MPDs, which is the second way. And this was inaugurated much before Kolmogorov by Joseph Fourier from a phenomenological point of view in 1807, and then the main paper was in 1822. So sometimes engineering science goes much before rigorous modelization, which is very important to know. You have to trust the models, if they are good enough, of course. You don't know which model will be good enough, but if you are in good company, finally you know. So let me go to the heat propagation, which seems to be the same thing in the end as the Brownian motion, look at in a different perspective. So the problem that of the heat equation is that much of the theory is already done. So what is Juan Luis telling us today? Well, you may do linear models that are essentially similar to the heat equation, but maybe you can do nonlinear models. And this has a name. Everything that is good enough has a name. We call them parabolic theory. So the heat equation goes on to become a linear theory for parabolic equations and a nonlinear theory for parabolic equations. And then if you get the stationary states of these diffusion processes in the form of parabolic equations, then you end up with elliptic equations. And the elliptic equations are very nice because they are like the core of PDEs. If you do something on elliptic equations, the number of people who will be able to read is like a factor of seven at least with respect to the people who can read the same paper with parabolic. So it is a very good idea to be next to elliptic equations because they are so basic. And then if you go to the elliptic equations and you want to go more to the kernel of elliptic equations, you find that the Laplacian is the basic operator. This is the king of differential operators for these elliptic and parabolic people. And it is very good that I introduce now our new friend. The fractional Laplacian is not the main Laplacian. I mean, the main Laplacian is Laplacian, delta. But the fractional Laplacian is close family and has been object of lots of attention. People have focused on this in the present day because they are very important variations with respect to the main Laplacian. And they are related to something that in general is called non-local long-range operators in probability. And this in functional analysis in PDEs is called the fractional Laplacian family. So the problem is that maybe with this panorama of parabolic, elliptic, linear or nonlinear, elliptic and fractional, we can go on and treat complex systems in the modeling of realistic phenomena. Well, this is another step. I mean, the numbers, bullet one, bullet two, and bullet three are basic theory. Bullet four is advanced theory. You have to know the basic theory first, and then you do the applications in any order. And if you want to do the really complex systems, you remember that, I mean, this is something we have been discussing with Rodriguez many years. You have to do some modeling, some analysis, some stochastics, some asymptotics, and some numerics. Can you do all of them well? No. But if you have enough number of friends, we can do like an army of people who can have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 sections and work in this modeling world. Okay. And well, I did my contribution to the theory thanks to my friends who invited me to write it for a conference that was held in Cetraro, in Italy. Wonderful place, Cetraro. And in 2016, so if you want to read more or less this theory in lots of detail, I wrote this thing. And there was a volume, and the authors were Carrillo, Del Pino, Figali, Mingione, and myself. And the editors were Matteo Bonforte and Gabriele Grillo. And this is what I mean when I talk about the mathematical army. You need some friends in different parts of the field that will tell you what you don't know. And I mean, this is good company. Let me repeat them: Jose Antonio, Manuel, Alessio, Giuseppe, Matteo, and Gabriele. Okay, and this is a book of friends. Okay, fractional diffusion. Let me go on with this generic presentation by recalling that the idea of these fractional operators came from the people in diffusion, in probability. They really realized that in many processes, the standard Brownian motion that has a transition probability based on the Gaussian kernel, in fact, Kolmogorov said that the PDEs related to the Brownian motion where the heat equation, and the heat equation has a Gaussian, and they say that the Gaussian is not realistic for many phenomena in nature where the distance at which you can reach a response, an interaction, is a long distance. If particles collide in a container by bumping into each other, maybe it's realistic that you get the Brownian motion, and the influence of the Gaussian kernel at long distance decays exponentially fast. I mean, more than exponentially, square exponentially fast, which is a terrible decay. But it has been observed, for instance, in the new world, in particular, for instance, in information theory, that now you can talk not only with people in Madrid or Lisbon, but also with people in Tokyo or Bangalore or Calcutta with the same effort. So the possibility of talking at the same time with people in Lisbon and people in Saigon is very realistic, and the Markovian density has to be changed into something else. And well, they found that they should be using kernels that decay like powers. In fact, the first person who worked around this idea of the powers seems to be the famous economist from Italy, Pareto. And there is this Pareto distribution in the economy. Okay, so once the probabilist people discovered this idea and worked on this idea, the analytic part of this idea was putting into the place. And then you find what is the equivalent of the Laplacian in parabolic or in elliptic that has to replace the Gaussian kernel and the heat equation. And well, the first thing you do is putting a symbol. I mean, you first find what is the object, and then in order to explain to the public, you get a nice symbol. Now, this minus operation to the power s seems to be a nice symbol. So it's a question of opinion, but this is the symbol we use. And this is called the fractional Laplacian. So, well, I was very happy in my life without paying any attention to these fractionals. And the people in stochastic process were using this, and I didn't know anything, but the people in harmonic analysis knew. And then I knew the topic from the work done by the group of Professor Caffarelli in Texas. And he did a very important paper on that with Luis Silvestre in 2007. This is a classical, an extension problem related to fractional Laplacian. And then I had to read it because Luis Caffarelli insisted that we stop with our previous work. You, Juan Luis, learn this, and that's it. You know, Caffarelli had an opinion, I followed. So I had to learn this stuff. And the idea is that if you go to the harmonic people, the stuff is much simpler than I thought. You define the Laplacian by Fourier analysis. You take the transform of the Laplacian, fractional Laplacian applied to a function, and you define this transform by the multiplication of a multiplier times the transform of the function. And the multiplier, in the case of the pure Laplacian, is C to the square. In the case of the fractional Laplacian, is the fractional interpolation. And this, I mean, it cannot be simpler. Problem is now define this in proper way and learn all the functional analysis and Fourier analysis to work with this. And the people in Fourier analysis did the work for us to invert this product of two functions in Fourier space. And they found the convolution of the anti-transform of this, anti-transform of this, and you get the solution, which is the Laplacian of S applied to U. And then they did something that is eliminate this UX, and then this is like the convolution. And the convolution is multiplying U by the kernel corresponding to C square and integrating. And then what they found is the integral is singular. And in almost every point, the value is infinity. So you have to renormalize. And these people were good enough, in particular, it was the work of Naum Lankov in Russia and Eli Stein in the United States around the 70s. And it was based on former work by Marcel Riesz, that if you put UX in the numerator, then you can do so that this integral is finite. And the idea is that even if the denominator has a power that is too singular, more than the dimension of space, in the numerator, if U is a regular function, you have always a power of X minus Y because of Hölder or Lipschitz continuity. So you cancel the power upstairs with the 2S downstairs, and this is integrable. So there is a singular integral that you can do. Now, the problem of the singular integral is that this is for harmonic people. You go back to the people in stochastic processes and you find that they are doing Levy processes instead of the Markovian process of the Brownian motion. And you have to say that this and this is the same guy. And it takes some time, but then there is something called the continuous limit of a Markovian process and the infinitesimal generator. The infinitesimal generator of this process is this operator. And this, for instance, there are very beautiful lecture notes by Enrico Valdi Nocci. So I will not have to explain that. But then if you want to do nonlinear analysis, all of this linear theory doesn't work because nonlinear analysis is based on a priori estimates and is based on integration by parts. And there is, it is not very easy with all of these three definitions, integration by parts. So you have to do something to do nonlinear processes. And then Luis Caffarelli discovered the way of defining the fractional Laplacian, but what you call the extension operator. And I will not go very much into that because many people know that, but this was the content of this famous paper by Caffarelli and Silvestre in 2007. And let me say that once you define this fractional Laplacian like a boundary operator corresponding to an extension, so this equation upstairs is the elliptic equation in one dimension more, in n plus one dimensions. And y is the extra dimension. And what you do is that to define the Laplacian of a function that is only a function of x, no y, first you make the extension and then you do the weighted Neumann data. So it's a kind of Neumann to data, to Dirichlet to Neumann operator. I will not go into that because this is not my talk. It's just to tell you where you can read this. And where these guys who were, the Stinga is a guy from Buenos Aires and Torrea is a professor in Autonoma. And they did in a paper in 2010, an explanation that you can do this for many operators. Wave operators, Fokker-Planck operators, and this is very good for people who can do different models. Well, then we talked to the people in functional analysis and they were very unhappy because they had another definition of the fractional Laplacian based on semigroup theory. And so there is this point. If you make a definition for an operator in five different ways, are you sure that it is the same? And the answer is yes, and the answer is no. The answer is yes, if you are working in the whole space, in RN. So most of what we did for many of these last 15 years was to work in the whole space because all of these five definitions are the same. But then if you work in a bounded domain, they are not the same. in particular in a bounded domain, you cannot do Fourier analysis. So stop it. You can do microanalysis. That is different. It doesn't work very well.
Could I quickly ask a question?
Yeah.
So the function spaces that these operators are defined on, in particular the semigroup one, when you speak of the equivalence, is that also that they are all naturally identifying the same function spaces in which these operators are defined?
Yes, this is carefully written by a Polish guy whose name is Kwasniewski. And in the reference I gave, it is quoted. And he says there are even 10 different definitions that are interesting for the functional analysis people. And he proves equivalence after defining the proper domain of operator of each of these operators. Yeah. And so, in the common domain, they are the same.
Yeah, so what I had in mind is a recent talk that I bumped into of Brezis, who was speaking about new formulations of interpolation spaces based on this harmonic analysis approach. Yes. So there were subtler spaces than just the regular Sobolev space for the PDE people. So I was trying to also connect to that.
Yes. In fact, we're very interested now in talking to the functional analysis people about these functional properties of the operators and definitions and what is the relation with Sobolev spaces. I have a paper that you can read in archive with Lorenzo Brasco. And it is the last year. It is already published. And we will go into the proper definition with all the functional spaces.
Super, thank you.
I mean, it's very interesting subject that many people are working on that. It's serious difficulty. Okay, thank you for the question. Okay, so I think that my time of panoramic is getting to an end. I just to finish this part, let's go to the simplest equation to see if this definition works. Well, you take X in Rn because we want to use all the possible definitions. We don't want the complications. Maybe we want to use Fourier analysis to start. And then we take initial data in L1 because it seems that L1 is a very good space for people in probability. Well, you can do measure spaces, but you know, probably it is good in L1. And this model is what people in probability know, the Levy process, the linear flow generated by the Levy process. And there is this probability transition that we don't care. And the idea is that the limit from random walk to this equation was carefully stated by Enrico Valdinocchi in 2009 in a beautiful paper. And then let me tell you what you can do. Once you know the trick, you can do it. Functional analysis ready. You take Fourier analysis and you solve it and you discover that instead of getting convolution with the parabolic kernel, which is the Gaussian, you get the convolution to the fractional parabolic kernel, which is the P function defined by Blumenthal and Gettur, a couple of probabilists in 1960s. And then this function has what they were very interested in saying. It is a kernel function for a probabilistic process that works so that the decaying time is like a power. So it is not an exponential. It's what they call a tail, a power tail. And this is what they want to call a power tail. In fact, they call it fat tail. And then this was known, but with Matteo Bonforte and Yannick Sir in 2017, we wrote a paper to prove to the people in PDEs that this definition by convolution implies optimal existence and uniqueness theory for fractional heat equation in the sense of semigroups. Well, and you published this, and it's okay. But it's not very difficult. So I finish this part by recalling to you that you get the heat equation. And then if you go in the vertical direction, you get the fractional heat equation. But in my former life, I was doing porous medium, which is nonlinear. Instead of being fractional, it's nonlinear. And I was also doing peel ablations, which is very typical of the Italian school, because in the elliptic case, peel ablations are related to Gallardo norms. So this was two things I was doing in the nonlinear field.
Okay.
And then you see that you can get different definitions that you can go on along the branches that join fractional equations with porous medium equation or with fractional peel ablations. And this is like a beginning picture of, let's say, a panoramic view of the number of equations that are related to different models of how a diffusion process can be realistic or not in time. So let me talk in the last part of my talk about a very particular thing that I am doing now. If you have any question about the two first chapters, please feel free to ask me. Otherwise, we will discuss at the end. Okay, so you're ready now for this practical part of my work that I did in the last 3 years. When I got a pension, I became emeritus, and then I had free time, which is good. So the Gallardo norm, and this is a new reflection just to connect with elliptic people, otherwise they are not interested, and it's a pity, because maybe this is beautiful. So let's go to the functional analysis people, Brezis school and the Italian school and so on. If you want to define the fractional Sobolev spaces, well, you define the Gallardo Slobodetsky Sobolev fractional spaces by this formula number one, where instead of integrating with respect to a kernel, you double integrate with respect to a double kernel. So it's a double integral. This is the trick that allowed analytic people to define the interpolation spaces in an analytic way. You can define the interpolation spaces, but what you call the real or complex interpolation theory that PDE people, we don't understand it very well. I remember working with Lorenzo Brasco, and it was a hard time for me, but he knew that. And so we went back to this formula as much as possible. So once you realize that you are working on solid space and solid space for the elliptic people, then you say, well, okay, this thing, let me call it the semi-norm. This coefficient P is just for the rigorous part, just to put the numbers one. But this functional, the raised to the P is the Gallardo semi-norm. And then if you want to define the norm, you add the LP norm. And then you can consider all the fractional exponents and all the powers P from one to infinity and all the dimensions. And of course, you will ask me, what are the limit cases? When S is zero, when S is one, when P is one, when P is infinity, but this is particularities of the theory. And it is not easy, but you can do it. I mean, this reference for this basic idea of the operators, you can read it in Dinezza, Palatucci, Valdinocci. They put a funny name because this Hitchhiker's Guide is related to a book we used to read when we were young. People know Hitchhiker's Guide to the Universe. And our universe is fractional Sobolev spaces. Okay, so now let me go to the partial differential equations. The first thing you do is in two steps. First thing you do is defining the Euler-Lagrange equation, the first variation. And you find that if you find the first variation of this thing, you get the power P minus one with a sign. Let me write it as capital phi. It is the power p minus 2 times c, and c is a vector. The people in p Laplacians know that. And then this operator is what we call the S fractional p Laplacian operator. If p equals 2, is the standard theory. Brezis proved and other people proved that when p tends to 2, this tends to the typical Dirichlet integral, and this is the Laplacian. And now second step. And then I do the evolution. And the evolution of this operator, which comes from a functional, which is an energy. So this is what they call the flow of the subdifferential or the gradient flow. So people in functional analysis knew that this can be done. And the problem is do the details. So I want to do X in the whole space, dimensions larger than one and for all times and initial data. So this is the Cauchy problem. And then I did a paper with P larger than two, which you call the standard case. And then people in elliptic equations know that the fast diffusion case is really difficult. And the reference for these difficulties of the elliptic theory is the book by Emanuele Di Benedetto. And he says that P less than two is has problems. Okay. So what we did is trying to do the simplest theory. And reflecting on that simplest theory, the idea is that the heat equation is easier in a bounded domain than in the whole space. Because in the bounded domain, the solution is separation of variables, which is this formula. This is the separation of variables in a bounded domain. While in the whole space, the solution is the Gaussian kernel, which is more difficult. So it looks like the theory in bounded domain is easier. And then there was work that we did around 2016, number of people. In particular, these are people from Valencia, Mazón. Bueno, Rossi is now in Buenos Aires, in Toledo. And then there is a guy I don't know, but he did a very nice paper, Pust. And I wrote a paper doing the asymptotic behavior and proving that there is a nonlinear eigenvalue and a potential, not an exponential, a power of time. And this is what I did in 2016, and it was done. I will not do this here. What I will do is try to concentrate in the whole space. And what is the problem? Yeah, at the beginning, the problem is no problem, because people know that P Laplacian, even the fractional P Laplacian, is subdifferential. So it's well defined in L2. You can prove that it has a bounded domain. No, sorry, a dense domain in L2. And the semigroup is a contraction semigroup in all LP spaces. And this is something that I was a student of Brezis. So this I know, thanks God. And then once you define the continuous semigroup, you get a continuous strong solution in L2, in L2, L1, or all LP spaces. And this goes very well with analytic people. And then you prove these smoothing theorems, which they call also hypercontractive. And any function that begins in L1 is immediately bounded. The basic regularity that you prove. And then once it is L infinity, you prove that this holder. And this was already done in 2019. And then there is something from theory, from geometric theory, that I will jump. Alexandrov principle. I had to study a lot of this Russian school theory. Alexandrov was one of the great. And then I wanted to prove if there is free boundaries or no. And to my surprise, there are no free boundaries. So I cannot do this free boundary theory that Jose Francisco likes so much. And then I had to do the analysis, the very careful detailed analysis. And you do it by renormalizing the flow, by using a scale invariance. So let me tell you what is the result. The result in the end is relatively simple. Once you know all of this stuff, it takes some time to absorb it and put it in order. The result is it works as it should. It says that if you have an initial probability density with a certain, well, not probability, let's say that the integral is capital M, more than one, population density, then the P Laplacian fractional flow has a unique self-similar solution that begins with the Dirac delta. This is called the fundamental solution of the flow. The flow is non-linear, but if it begins with Dirac delta, you call it fundamental. And it has a power of time outside and a power of time inside. The dependence on M, if you want to make your life simple, put M equals one so that you get a probability. And then according to Barenblatt theory, alpha and beta are probably dimensional exponents and you can calculate them a priori. And then the problem is, what is the profile? Is this profile Gaussian? And I proved that the profile F of this similar solution decreases like it was expected to do. And this is what was very difficult to prove, that the decay in space of the SP Laplacian kernel in the evolution is a decay with a power, a fat tail, and the power is N plus SP. Now, in 1960, Blumenthal and Gettor used Fourier analysis to prove that for P equals 2, you get N plus 2S. Without any Fourier analysis, I worked and worked to prove that this result has, instead of 2S, SP. And then how do you prove it? Okay, first is I talked to my numerical friend who was my student, Felix, and since he's my friend, which is a terrible thing to do, he has to work. So he produced these profiles for me. This is a similar solution profile when S is 1/2 and P is 2. So this is the typical Blumenthal solution. And this is what happens with PX4. And black is what happens when P is 8. And you will see, if you are good in applied mathematics, that this is the famous Mesa. But I cannot prove that there is a Mesa rigorously. And then numerical analysis can tell you if this decay is really what it should be. It's very difficult to see if this is a power or another power. But in numerical analysis, you take logarithmic axis, and if it is a power, the function that has a power decay becomes a straight line. And checking that if a function looks like a straight line is easy. So we checked it. So we have the numerical evidence that the result was good numerically. And then the computed graphics were done with a numerical code that we are developing, but it works very well. We have no rigorous numerical proof. I didn't need it, but anyway. And then the idea is that, can you use this fundamental solution to prove a general result for any solution that begins with an initial datum L1, with initial density L1? And it's, for instance, a probability density. And this is the result you prove. The difference between your real density and the similar density, you take the L1 norm and goes to zero. And if you take the L infinity norm, you multiply by a certain scaling factor and still goes to zero. Okay, so once you do this, you are finished with the asymptotic analysis. So why was it difficult for me? Well, just the things that were known. Fundamental solutions are a basic ingredient in the theory of the heat equation because of the Gaussian profile. And also for other linear parabolic equations. So there is a whole theory about parabolic equations with coefficients that depend on X and T, and you want to know if they had a good fundamental solution or a parametrics, as they call it. And then if you go to the nonlinear diffusion, you cannot use convolutions because it's nonlinear, but still the fundamental solutions are there and you can prove that they will give you the asymptotic behavior. And this was done in Russia by Zeldovich and Barenblatt in the 1950s. They were the incredibly good group in plasma physics in Lomonosov. And well, they were lucky because the solutions were, fundamental solutions were explicit. They were the famous Barenblatt solutions. And then you think that maybe you can prove that these solutions are very good attractors of the other solutions. And this is what you call rate of convergence. And this is difficult. I have some papers with friends, Carrillo, Blanchet, and Dalbo, but it is difficult stuff. So let me tell you that the proof of this asymptotic behavior is relatively similar to what the previous literature said. But since you have the P Laplacian with fractional, you cannot use the methods. You have to change them. And then the idea is that you have to think what you have a toolbox, and you think what is the basic thing that you can save to prove that there is an object called the fundamental solution. If you do approximation with regular kernels and get the numerical solution and try to pass to the limit in the a priori estimates, what is the basic thing? Well, the basic thing for me that was missing was, if you don't get a sharp upper barrier, the solutions are not justified to be convergent. They can be divergent. So the problem for me was to construct an upper barrier. And as you probably know, constructing upper barriers is something that in Gaffarelli school is, you have to do it every day. Once you get the new ingredient, the sharp upper barrier, you get the scaling transformations that we will see, the famous L1 L infinity effect, the conservation of the mass, local compactness of the semigroups. This is people in functionalities know that. A strict positivity of the solutions. And then in particular, you prove there are no free boundaries. This is what the numerical analysis shows. And then it's very important to use Lyapunov functionals to prove that things converge. And then you can prove it. I mean, it takes some time to prove it, but this blueprint, you go to my paper, you can follow it. And then you go to the limit cases because, I mean, people ask you questions. People are very curious nowadays. They want to know everything. So the problem is now for me, in the last minutes, let me just say some words on that. The fast diffusion flow, the problem is what? You want to know what is the problem. I mean, there is a problem that I worked hard for 1 year under the pandemic to solve. And since I had so much free time, I could do it. And there is a difficulty that was not present for P larger than 2. It is that the construction of the similar solution is trickier because in some exponents, there are no similar solutions. When P is much below P equals 2 and P is near P equals 1, the whole setup breaks down and there are no similar solutions. And then you have to know what happens. And happens that what happens is something called extinction in finite time. So then you say, well, what do I do first? What I did in the paper that I've been telling you is trying to see how many P's allow for a similar solution. And then there is a magical number, 2n over n plus s. This is the limit. When you get to this limit, everything breaks down. And I can prove that if you go below. Sorry. This breaks down. And then you want to know this PC is really something that comes from the theory, and maybe this is like because you cannot do it better, or is it really essential? It is essential. And then you want to know also, if you get the real decays, are you able to prove that solutions decay like they should? And this is very strange. I had to work a lot. The solutions decay like a power tail, what they are called fat tails, but they have different behavior according to the P and the S. There is a trade-off between nonlinearity and fractionality. And the trade-off has a new power that is very strange, a solution of an algebraic quadratic equation, and then you get for power less than p1, you get a power. For larger than p1, you get another power. And then what is the picture? Let me see. The picture is, this is the power, and these are the p's. I am going to be between 2 and 1. The number of powers that belong to similar solutions are from PC to 2. In this range, fractional wins, and you get the fractional tail, which is m plus sp. In this range, nonlinearity wins, and you get the nonlinearity power that is sp over 2 minus p. So I was able to explain that there is a trade-off between nonlinearity and fractionality, and everyone wins in one of the places, and you can realize what is the tail. And this takes some time because I don't know, it's difficult to get along all of these crazy computations. In the end, when you realize what it is, takes some time, but it's natural. This is very disappointing when you talk to people in physics and tell them that you found this, and they say, oh, yeah, this is very natural. And you don't know what to do. Kill them. So the theorem of asymptotic behavior says that if you are above the PC power, the theorem says the same thing, but the proof is different. And this is what happens with these theorems, where the result is the same, but the proof is every time more complicated. So the theorem for P less than 2 is the same until it is not the same. And the critical power is PC. And I want to tell you, just to finish here, that sometimes people want to know, wow, how do you do the analysis, what is this renormalized idea that I use to produce an orbit that is compact? The idea is that you change the variable into a renormalized variable. Instead of u, you use v, and v is a change of variables with powers. And the new equation is this one. And people in the entropy community know that this is the renormalized equation. Now, if you put here dt of v equals 0, you get a stationary solution. So the stationary solution is this. And this is the famous nonlinear eigenvalue problem that will be my barrier when I do a super solution for this monster. So in fact, the barrier was not so difficult. You renormalize the flow and you get a super solution for the barrier, for the stationary case. And then these are the graphs for the fast thing. And one of the difficulties, just to show you a particular case, is that I was not able to prove Hölder continuity for p less than 2. And I was really desperate trying to prove the whole paper without Hölder continuity. And then talking to people, I discovered this wonderful friend, Antonio Giannizzotto, who had a proof that Hölder continuity is true. It was incredible. He didn't know that. He thought that his paper was good only for elliptic. So this is a good consequence of talking to people. And I think that I will stop here because the rest is too much. Thank you.